Our Father in heaven, truly as the song that was just sung has said, that the world is to know us by our love, your love that's within us. It's to fulfill the prayer of our Savior in John 17, a prayer that we are to study to fulfill, that the world might know Jesus Christ whom you have sent. Our unity, our love one for another, this is our prayer for 2016, that the world around us would know Christ by the love that we have towards one another. Father, bless us. And we ask, Father, this morning as we open your word, that you would walk with us, Lord, as we run to and fro in the Bible, that you would lead us in the scriptures, that as we are studying some deeper truths, we pray, Father, for the mind of Christ, not only the mind of self-sacrificing love, but the mind that understands the deep things of God. Therefore, we pray for your Spirit. Lead us and guide us into all truth is our prayer in Christ's name. Amen. As the brethren are moving the chairs for us, just these two here, and these two there. I have to remember something that I promised that I would do. I promised my family members, the ones that are in the hospital that you've been praying for. Many of you have gone to visit them. And specifically, my Uncle Phil made me promise before I left on, what was it, Friday, New Year's, right? New Year's Day. Before we left New Year's Day, he made me promise with tears in his eyes and tears in his voice to thank everyone for coming into, you know, praying for them and visiting them. He was very adamant that he really feels love here, and he's really thankful, even though he is not an official member of the church. It was our church that was the first on the scene to visit them in the hospital and to pray with them, and that really meant a lot to him, as well as to my mother and the other family members. So they made me promise that I would say thank you. And I'm sure they're watching this morning as they usually do, you know, when they're able to. And so I did what you asked me to do, Uncle Phil. And my mother also sends her love. And I want to ask you to continue to pray for them. Everyone is mending well, except Brother Bill is still, Brother Spetnagel is still in critical condition. Is that right? Still in critical condition. He's not doing too well. So I want to ask that you continue to pray for him. And if you still have the opportunity, they're going to be in the hospital for quite some time. They're mending, and they'll be there for a good long while. I know my mother, she won't be able to put any weight on her legs for at least 2 months. So after 2 months, then she's going to have some rehabilitation. So she'll be there for a while. So if you have an opportunity to run back up there to just see them for a minute, that would greatly encourage them. And so I really encourage you to do so. All right? So with that being said, I'm going to ask if is Danny present? I see him running away back there. Oh, he's passing them out. All right. I'm going to go ahead and have him pass out the papers. All right. So everyone should be getting a paper. If you're able to read, I always like you to get your own copy, all right? So if you know how to read, let's give everybody a copy if you can read, all right? So if you don't have a copy, raise your hand so we can make sure that you get a copy. All right, there's one here in the front. Make sure you get a copy. Don't forget Elder Arsenal there in the back at the sound booth. You got one? All right. I'm going to make sure everyone gets one. Now, this is not the same as you got last week. Last week, there was many quotations. This week, same thing. A little bit different than my usual style, my usual format. I usually give a lot more Bible than quotes. And we'll still have a lot of Bible today. But I want you to get that paper. And once you have it, give me an amen so I know that you're there with me. All right, so I'm going to be looking at the same thing that you're looking at. I want to just make sure that everybody has a paper. Has everybody been served? Everybody have a paper? Amen? All right, now, We're in our series on the seven shepherds and eight principal men, and I've purposefully left the last two pillars, which is the pillar of the third angel, the three angels' messages, as well as the messages of Adventism's past, the messages that are on the charts behind me that you probably can't see because they're covered by the whiteboard, but that they're every Sabbath, the 1843 and 1850 charts. These charts contain the messages of Adventism's past, and we will go through them point by point by point together in the future. However, for the purpose of this particular series, we want to cover some things that will normally not be covered when we talk about the three angels' messages or these particular charts. And so we're studying about the three angels' messages, and last week, if you have your paper, last week, let's just review what we looked at. You have page one on your paper, and we'll just look under that review. We talked about how the three angels' messages represent a work of God's people. So if you weren't here the last week, we can give you the handout for that as well if you would like one. But we read many different quotations. We looked at scripture showing that the three angels of Revelation chapter 14 don't just represent messages, and they are not literal angels flying in the midst of heaven with these loud voices giving a message. It symbolizes God's people and the exalted character of the work in which we are to engage in. Then we learned that the messages of the three angels are past history, the history that has been fulfilled. And we read many statements talking about the first, the second, the third angel, how they have been fulfilled. We learned that these represent three vital steps, all right? Step one, step two, step three. And we spent a great deal of time reading quotation after quotation showing that these messages are to be given in their order. In other words, first angel is followed by third angel, correct? No, it's followed by what? Second angel. And the second is followed by the third. And when we're giving the messages, they have to come in their order. One, two, three. Very important. You might not understand why, but we'll get into that a little bit specifically. Well, we'll see about today. See if we can get into that today. We also learned that history repeats itself. All right, we gave scripture and spirit of prophecy that history is repetitive. However, just because history repeats does not mean that we are doomed to repeat history. And it kind of seems like that is it kind of cancels itself out. You say it repeats, but you don't have to repeat it. But it really doesn't, because inspiration identifies what repeats. And we read how it's the parable of the 10 virgins that repeats to the very letter. And that parable represents the experience of God's people, the experience of the Advent movement. And that experience will repeat to the very letter. And we read quite a few statements regarding that as well. Now, this particular parable is representing the three angels of Revelation 14. So the parable, if you're taking notes, the parable of Matthew 25, the parable of the 10 virgins, is also Revelation 14, 6 through 12. It's the messages of the three angels. But it's also what we're going to look at this morning, specifically Revelation chapter 10. All right, Revelation chapter 10 is Revelation 14, is Matthew 25. And so these chapters, these teachings, these doctrines, the experience, the history that fulfills these chapters is to be repeated. We'll see that this morning. And we looked as well, the last bullet point there you have is that specific events will repeat. And these are the events of the three angels' messages, all right? So they were fulfilled in times past, and we're talking this morning specifically about the time in which they were fulfilled. We're going to locate the first angel, the second angel, the third angel, and then we're going to, next week, by the grace of God, look into its repetition for our day. So we're going to look at some history today, and then next week we'll get into some current things that are taking place. Is that all right? All right, so we're doing a bit of Bible study today. Now go with me in your Bibles to the book of Revelation chapter 10. Revelation chapter 10. Now we briefly talked about this last week, so we're going to touch this again. And especially for those of you who are just coming back maybe from vacation, seeing your family, so on and so forth, this will be greatly beneficial for you as well as for everyone else, because repetition deepens the impression. So we're in the book of Revelation chapter 10. We're going to start in verse 1, and we've already read through verse 7 in our scripture reading, but let's read to verse 10. So Revelation chapter 10, verse 1 through 10. The Bible says, "And I saw another mighty angel come down from heaven, clothed with a cloud, and a rainbow was upon his head, and his face was as it were the sun, and his feet as pillars of fire. And he had in his hand a little book open, and he set his right foot upon the sea and his left foot upon the earth, and cried with a loud voice as when a lion roareth. And when he had cried, seven thunders did what? Utter their voices. And when the seven thunders had uttered their voices, I was about to write. And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, seal up those things which the seven thunders uttered, and write them not. And the angel which I saw stand upon the sea and upon the earth lifted up his hand to heaven, and swear by him that liveth forever and ever, who created heaven and the things that therein are, and the earth and the things which therein are, and the sea and the things which are therein, that there should be time no longer. But in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, when he shall begin to sound, the mystery of God should be finished, as he has declared to his servants, the prophets. And the voice which I heard from heaven spake unto me again and said, go and take the little book which is open in the hand of the angel, which standeth upon the sea and upon the earth. And I went unto the angel and said unto him, give me the little book. And he said unto me, take it and eat it up, and it shall make thy belly what? Bitter, but it shall be in thy mouth sweet as honey. And I took the little book out of the angel's hand and ate it up, and it was in my mouth sweet as honey, and as soon as I had eaten it, my belly was bitter." Now, on the first quotation that you will have on your paper is from Selected Messages, Volume 2. All right, on page 1, you have Selected Messages, Volume 2, page 107 to 108. And let's just read the highlighted portion together. It says, "The disappointment of those who expected to see their Lord in 1844 was indeed what? Bitter to those who had ardently looked for his appearing. It was in the Lord's order that this disappointment should come and that hearts should be revealed. Not one cloud has fallen upon the church that God has not prepared for, and not one opposing force has risen to counterwork the work of God, but he has foreseen. All has taken place as he had predicted through his prophets. He has not left his church in darkness, forsaken, but has traced in prophetic declarations that which would occur, and through his providence, acting in its appointed place in the world's history. He has brought about that which his Holy Spirit inspired the prophets to foretell." Now, this particular statement is in reference to Revelation chapter 10. So what the prophet is doing is she's showing you that the history of Revelation chapter 10, or the events that we just read about in the Bible, is the experience of the disappointment of the Millerites. So Revelation 10 is Millerite history. If you've never read, or if you've ever read through Revelation chapter 10 before, and you were going through it and you were reading through it, what you were reading about was the history of the Millerites. The Millerites, did they have a bitter disappointment? Yes or no? Yes, they did. All right, they had a very bitter experience. As a matter of fact, verses 8 through 10 of Revelation chapter 10 is the experience of the Millerites. This is the parable of Matthew 25. All right, so Revelation chapter 10, 8 through 10 is the what of the Millerites? The experience of the Millerites. But verses 1 through 7 is the history that brings about the experience. All right, so that's very important. All right, so Revelation chapter 10, 1 through 7 is the history, the events that bring about the experience of verses 8 through 10. So what God does in Revelation chapter 10 is he gives you the events, then he gives you the experience that is the result of the events. All right, now these things we're told are going to repeat. Now, if you look in verse 11 just quickly with me, verse 11, after looking at the history, verses 1 through 7, after looking after the experience, verses 8 through 10, notice verse 11. It says in Revelation chapter 10, verse 11, "And he said unto me, thou must what? Prophesy how? Again before many peoples and nations and tongues and kings." All right, so let me ask this question. If verse 1 through 7 is the events, the history, you with me so far? Verses 8 through 10 is the corresponding experience. All right, because of the events that took place, this is the result. Here's the experience. With me so far? Now verse 11 tells you, go and prophesy again before many peoples, nations, languages, and kings. What is that verse telling you? What is it telling you in verse 11 when it says go and prophesy again? It's going to what? It's going to repeat. It's going to happen again. So the events are going to take place again, and the experience are going to take place again. So if these things are going to take place again, friends, then it would behoove us to understand the history and the experience. Amen? So this is what Revelation 10 is all about here. Now, we'll stay in Revelation 10. I tell you what, look at verse 6 with me. We briefly touched this last week as well. Revelation chapter 10 and verse 6. The Bible says, and he swear by him that liveth forever and ever, who created heaven and the things that therein are, and the earth and the things that therein are, and the sea and the things which are therein, that there should be what? Time no longer. All right, so we briefly talked about this last week. I'm going to repeat it for you today. When the Bible speaks of time here, there are three types of time in the Bible. One is literal time, right? The time in which we're living, right? The other is probationary time. And then the final one is prophetic time. Now, as a student, you go through each types of time. The angel here swears that time is no longer. So you ask yourself the question, is the angel talking about literal time, probationary time, or prophetic time? And the way that you can determine this is by verse 11. Verse 11 tells you to go and prophesy again. So if we were to go and preach again and repeat the experience again, is it talking about that literal time is over? No, because if literal time is over, why go and give the message again? Right? So it's not literal time. Is it probationary time? Probationary time is over, so go and preach a message. No. When probation closes, there's no more message to give. So it's not probationary time. So then what does it leave us with? Prophetic time. Prophetic time is over. And we learned last week that all prophetic time ends in the autumn of 1844, October 22, 1844 to be exact. The longest reckoning of prophetic time reaches to the autumn of 1844. All right, and you have a statement there on your page, the very one that we kind of went through very quickly. But this is volume 2 of Selected Messages again, page 108. And I'll just read this in your hearing. You have it there on your paper. It says, the angel which I saw stand upon the sea and upon the earth lifted up his hand to heaven and swear by him that liveth forever and ever, who created heaven and the things that therein are, and the sea and the things which are therein, that there should be time no longer. This message announces the end of what? The prophetic periods. The disappointment of those who expected to see our Lord in what year? 1844 was indeed bitter to those who had ardently looked for his appearing. So we're talking about the end of prophetic periods. 1844 is the end of these prophetic periods. And so let me draw this on the board here for you. All right, we're coming to the end. So this is the autumn of 1844. All right, so I'm going to write this here. So we're looking at the autumn of 1844, October 22, if you want to be exact with the month and the day. Look at the next statement. Volume 7 of the Bible Commentary, page 971. We're still on page 1. It says, this time, which the angel declares with a solemn oath, is not the end of this world's history, neither of probationary time, but of prophetic time, which would precede the advent of our Lord. The longest reckoning reaches to the autumn of 1844. All right, so when we're talking about this timeline that we're going to start building on together, all right, we're looking at the end of the timeline. And I said this last week, for me, many times in the Bible, and it's not just for me, oftentimes this is how the Bible actually deals with things. It starts at the end and then walks you back to the beginning. All right, and that's, you know, I mention this often. How many of you like to do, like, mazes? You like mazes? I know my wife, she likes those kind of puzzles and mazes and things of that nature. I used to really like those when I was little. And so, you know, you print out a bunch of, you know, mazes, or have a book full of mazes. But I found out for me, the easiest way to do the maze is to go to end and then go backwards to start. All right, you're not cheating. You're not doing anything of that nature. You're still doing the maze, but I start at the end. And that's often how God does it as well. God will give you something, but he gives you the end, and then he gives you the details of how to get to the end. All right, so he starts at the end and then walks you back to the beginning. All right, and that's not outside of his nature. For in the Bible, in the book of Isaiah 46 and 47, 48, the Bible talks about how God showeth the end from the beginning. All right, so this is how the Lord works. Now, also, if you didn't know this, maybe you've read you've gone through your Bible and you wonder why Scripture is built the way it is. I remember when I was reading through the Bible, especially when you get into, you know, some of the poetic or prophetic books of Scripture, it often repeats itself. It'll tell you something, and then it kind of goes over that information again, and I was wondering why God does that. But you see, the Eastern mind does not reason like the Western mind. The Western mind, we reason from cause to what? To effect. The Eastern mind doesn't do that. You know, often also when we read from left to right, right? Eastern mind is backwards. They read from right to left, and they reason from effect to cause. And so when you understand that these are the men that wrote the Bible, when you go through Scripture, they deal with the end, and then it takes you back to the beginning. All right, that's how it does. It gives you the summary, and then it goes back and gives you detail. And so this is how the Bible is written. So in the book of Revelation, chapter 10, easily identified or easily identifiable is the end of prophetic time. The angel tells you that time is no longer, bringing us to the autumn of 1844. Now you have your paper. We'll get to those next statements in just a moment. Let me identify a few things for you before we go back to our paper. Look at Revelation 10 with me again. Revelation chapter 10. And look with me in verse 9 and 10. All right, so we're building our timeline. Now, I said this last week. I mentioned it a moment ago. And I'm going to mention it again. For the next couple presentations that we have together, we're not giving sermons. All right, we're having study time. Is that all right with you? You know, Sister White in Vision, she was saying that, you know, she saw that, you know, the Church of God would take a different order, how there would be far less preaching and more teaching. She saw that, you know, sermons on Sabbath would be in the form of Bible study. And so this is what we're going to do together because, friends, we really need to understand. We need to learn. So I'm going to take time and walk through these things because a lot of the stuff that we're going to be dealing with is heavy bread that most people don't consider. All right, so we're going to take our time. So we're writing out our timeline. And what we're doing, just to give you an understanding, is we're trying to identify the history that will repeat. Very easy. So what we're drawing on the board is the history that will what? Repeat. We're starting with the end, the autumn of 1844, October 22 to be exact. Look with me in Revelation chapter 10. Revelation chapter 10, and we're going to start in verse 9. When you're there with me, amen. All right, so before we read this, let me ask a question. What happened in the autumn of 1844? I know this is, I'm up here, but we can interact, right? This is what we call what? The Great Disappointment. Okay, so the autumn of 1844 is the Great Disappointment. Why do we call it the Great Disappointment? They expected Christ to come, right? But that's not why it's called the Great Disappointment. Usually, for an example, if I'm identifying a disappointment as the great one, there was what? A little one, right? So the great one identifies the biggest disappointment. So what we're going to show you is there's actually two disappointments. And many times in Adventism, we forget about the first one, but it's very important. All right, so it's the great disappointment. All right, but notice what your Bible says. Look at verse 9 and verse 10. And I want to see if you can see this here, okay? It says, "And I went unto the angel and said unto him, Give me the little book. And he said unto me, Take it and eat it up, and it shall make thy belly what? Bitter, but it shall be in thy mouth sweet as honey." Now remember the statement that we read. It's on your paper in volume 2 of Selected Messages, 107 to 108. She describes this bitter experience in the belly as the bitter disappointment. Did they have a bitter disappointment in the autumn of 1844? Yes, they did. Look at verse 10. And I took the little book out of the angel's hand and ate it up, and it was in my mouth sweet as honey, and as soon as I had eaten it, my belly was bitter. All right, now, what God is doing here is he's not just repeating himself. He's not just telling you in verse 9, all right, you're going to eat this and this is what's going to happen. And then in verse 10, he eats it and this is what's happening. That's not what's taking place here. On the surface, you see it that way, but what it's describing is two disappointments. Verse 9, you're going to eat it, it's going to make your belly bitter. Verse 10, I ate it, my belly was bitter. All right, it's really describing two disappointments. And I'm going to give you some statements on this. But the first disappointment was also in 1844, but it was not in the autumn, it was in the spring. The spring of 1844 is the first disappointment. All right, so I want you to just remember these things. And we're looking in our Bibles at a few things. Look at verse 1 of Revelation chapter 10. Okay, so I'm going to identify some things, put it on the board, then we're going to give you all the ways you can see this and prove it through Scripture and Spirit of Prophecy. Revelation chapter 10, look with me in verse 1. It says, and I saw another mighty angel come down from heaven, clothed with a cloud, and a rainbow was upon his head, and his face was as it were the sun, and his feet as pillars of fire. All right, so what do we see taking place in verse 1? There's a mighty angel, and what is he doing? He's coming down, okay? So, verse 6 identifies the end of prophetic time, autumn of 1844. Verse 9 and 10 gives you some of that experience we talked about and how their experience was bitter. And it describes two bitter experiences, one in verse 9, one in verse 10. This is what we would call the first disappointment. So I'll put in parentheses here 1D. All right, so first disappointment, and then 2D is what? Second disappointment, okay? Now we're reading in verse 1. We're kind of just jumping around, but you'll see why. We're reading in verse 1 about a mighty angel. And this mighty angel, what is he doing? He's coming down. So, as a student of prophecy, all right, so I'm not just teaching. I really want to encourage you and give you some ways in which when you study your Bible, you know what to do, okay? Whenever you read something in the Bible, you have to question it. And what I mean by that is not question it as far as doubt is concerned, but you read it and you say, okay, here's a mighty angel coming down. What is the question you would ask yourself? Why is it coming down, or what brought it down? So now you need to answer that question. What brings the mighty angel down? So verse 1 of chapter 10 tells you he's coming down. So where would you look for the cause of his descent? Before it. You have to go to context now. So verse 1, he's coming down. So now you need to look before it to find out what's bringing him down, right? All right, so look with me now, Revelation chapter 9, and let's start in verse 13. Revelation chapter 9, and we're going to start together in verse 13. The Bible says, and the sixth angel sounded, and I heard a voice from the four horns of the golden altar, which is before God, saying to the sixth angel, which had the trumpet, loose the four angels, which are bound in the great river Euphrates. And the four angels were loosed, which were prepared for how long? For an hour, and a day, and a month, and a year, for to slay the third part of men. Now, if you've ever read through the book of Revelation, you'll notice that there's many angels, right? We often talk about the three angels and the fourth angel, but here it's clear that there's at least, here's the sixth angel. He's saying to the four angels bound in the great river Euphrates. So there's a lot of angels. Right? And we need to understand, just like we learned last week, these angels, they don't represent literal angels flying in heaven. They're symbolic of messengers of the Lord. All right? So there are four messengers of the Lord that are bound up in the great river Euphrates. And in the great river Euphrates, these four angels, as it were, four messengers of the Lord, historically, are the four principal sultans of Islam. All right, so I'm going to say a few things and then we're going to go back and study them point by point through the charts, but just follow me. These four principal sultans of Islam were found in Aleppo, Iconium, Damascus, and Baghdad. All right, these four areas in the Middle East. Historically, there was a time where Islam is now loosed upon the earth. And they're loosed upon the earth for how long? An hour, a day, a month, and a year. Is that a time prophecy, yes or no? Yes. So with all time prophecies, you have to find a beginning. Or you have to find a beginning. Well, that doesn't really tell you the beginning. So you have to go back as well. So let's start in chapter 9, verse 1, just for a bit of context. Chapter 9, verse 1. Remember, we talked about verse 13, the sixth angel sounds. So what comes before the sixth? The fifth. All right, so look at verse 1. And the fifth angel sounded. And I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. And it says, and he opened the bottomless pit, and there rose a smoke out of the pit as the smoke of a great furnace. Now, our pioneers have correctly understood and correctly identified that this angel, this fifth angel that's sounding, and the star that falls from heaven, and this star, what did we learn last week stars represent? Do you remember? Angels. And angels represent messengers. All right, so here's a star coming down from heaven. This is an angel. He's a messenger. And the Bible shows given him is a key to the bottomless pit. And he opens this bottomless pit and smoke comes out of the pit. Now our pioneers taught that this represented Islam. And this angel that's given the key is the prophet Muhammad. All right, and we'll get into some of the details later. Okay. But the prophet Muhammad is the one coming now out of this. He's releasing the smoke out of the bottomless pit. Now, what comes out of the smoke? And let me just show you an easy way that you can identify this as Islam. Real easy, without a lot of Bible study. Look at verse 2. Look at verse 2. He opened the bottomless pit, and there arose a smoke out of the pit as the smoke of a great furnace. And the what? Sun and the air were darkened by the reason of the smoke of the pit. Now, in the beginning when God created the firmament, or the air, right? What did he put in the air? What three heavenly bodies did he put there? Sun, moon, and stars, right? It doesn't talk about, you know, Venus and Saturn and all these different things. Genesis simply says the sun, the moon, and he made the stars also. All right? So when the smoke is released and it blocks out the firmament and it blocks out the sun, what's left? The what? The moon and stars. Isn't it very interesting that the principal symbol for Islam is the crescent moon and star? All right, so in a very simple way, you can identify Islam just by their very symbol. All right, so this is Islam that's unleashed upon the earth. Now notice what it says in verse 3, and there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth, and unto them was given power as the scorpions of the earth have power. Where's the power of a scorpion? In its tail. And if you take in the Bible and you study the tail in the book of Isaiah chapter 9, 15, that the ancient and honorable, he's the head. But the prophet that teaches lies, he is the tail. And so when Islam is unleashed upon the earth, they're tormenting men like a scorpion. And the scorpion uses his tail, right? So the doctrines and religion of Islam is now unleashed upon the earth, headed by this false prophet. It says in verse 4, and it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which had not the seal of God in their foreheads. And so Islam, when it was unleashed upon the earth during this early time period in the 600s, they were not persecuting and tormenting and killing the people of God that kept the Sabbath. What they were unleashed upon, Islam does a specific work for God. Does a specific work for who? For God. God uses Islam. Remember, this is the angel, not the mighty angel, but the angel that falls from heaven, the star that falls from heaven, this messenger. And God rose up Muhammad to be a scourge against an apostate priesthood. Not those who kept the Sabbath, but those who supplanted the Sabbath for the first day of the week. And historically, Islam rose up against Christianity. Now, the Christianity I'm speaking about is not those people of the book that keep the law of God and the faith of Jesus, but we're talking about Catholicism. And so this is why it's very important, friends, even today, when you read about, you know, Islam persecuting Christians, the history of Islam, friends, Islam, even in the Quran, it talks about the people of the book, the people of the book. And Islam has no problem with the people of the book. And the people of the book are those who follow the religion of Abraham. They're known as Hanif. That would be you and I, by the grace of God. Islam shouldn't have a problem with you. But if you're eating pork and you're worshiping idols and you're unholy in your worship, irreverent in your worship, and you're worshiping, you know, what you know not, and you're keeping the first day of the week instead of the seventh day of the week, you are those that Islam was released to punish. That's the historical role of Islam. All right, and we can get into more of that later on. But notice what I'm saying here. Notice what it says in verse 5. It says, and to them it was given that they should not kill them, but that they should be tormented how long? 5 months. And their torment was as the torment of a scorpion when he striketh a man. All right, so for sake of time, when, instead of reading through all the verses, in verse 13, the sixth angel blows the sixth trumpet. And the Bible shows that there was a voice from heaven that says, release the four angels bound in the great river Euphrates. All right, these are the four principal sultans of Islam from Iconium, Aleppo, Iconium, Damascus, and Baghdad. And they were released for how long? An hour, a day, a month, and a year. So there's a time prophecy given, but you need to know the beginning of the time prophecy. So we go back into chapter 9, and it talks about the rise of Islam. And Islam, when it was risen, was given a first-time prophecy. And how long was the first-time prophecy in verse 5? I'm going to let you find it there. What is the first-time prophecy given Islam? 5 months. All right, so in order to understand the length of 5 months, we have to do a bit of Bible study. Now, you may have seen this before, but I just want to give it to you in the Scriptures. Go with me to Genesis. Genesis chapter 7. And I haven't forgotten about the mighty angel that comes down. We're trying to figure out what brings him down, all right? So notice Genesis chapter 7. Genesis chapter 7. Genesis chapter 7, let's start together in the 11th verse. Genesis chapter 7, what verse are we going to? Verse 11. If you're ever doing a Bible study with someone and you're giving them, prophecy study, you know, it's now time for you to study prophecy with them and you're going through time prophecies. You know, you're gonna, let me just ask this. How many days in a prophetic year? 360. Now the person would scratch their head and say, well, why in the Bible is time built on 360 days when we have 365 days? You know, how can you prove that to me? How do we know it's not 365? So you have to be able to prove to them 360 days. And one thing we need to correct ourselves on is that a biblical year or a prophetic year, yes, it has 360 days, but that's not prophetic time, that's Bible time. Sometimes we call it prophetic time, and that puts into our mind a seed that regular Bible time is different than prophetic time, and it's not. It's all 360 days. All right, so let me show you this in Scripture. So Genesis chapter 7, verse 11. Genesis 7, verse 11. The Bible says, in the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, in the 17th day of the month, it says, the same day were all the fountains of the great deep broken up and the windows of heaven were open. And then it began to rain. This is the flood, right? So the Bible gives you not only the year of Noah's life, but also the month and the day when the flood began. So what month did the flood begin in? What month? Well, no, not give me a day, all right? But just what month? Second month, right? Because the second month of the Bible wouldn't be our February. But it just says second month because they begin their year in the springtime, all right? So the spring was the time period of their Passover. This begins the year for them, all right? So it's a little bit different. But the Bible clearly says it's the second month. What day of the month? 17th day. And then we know there's a flood, right? Now notice what it says in verse 24. How long were the waters upon the earth? The Bible says, and the waters prevailed upon the earth how long? 150 days. All right, so it begins on the second month, on the 17th day, and the waters are upon the earth how long? 150 days. We know it rained 40 days and 40 nights, but the water was on the earth 150 days. So notice what it says now in verse 1 of chapter 8. And God remembered Noah and every living thing, and all the cattle that was with him in the ark. And God made a wind to pass over the earth, and the waters assuaged. In other words, they lowered. And the fountains also of the deep and the windows of heaven were stopped, and the rain from heaven was restrained. And the waters returned from off the earth continually, and after the end of how long? 150 days, the waters were abated. In other words, they were gone away. And the ark rested in the what month? Seventh month on the what day of the month? 17th day of the month upon the mountains of Ararat. Okay, question. What month did the waters begin? Second month. What day? 17th day of the month. Little Gasman raised his hand. That's why I was pointing at him. Right? He was trying to give the answer. So second month it begins, 17th day. How long were the waters on the earth? 150 days. When were the waters abated, gone away? Seventh month, what day of the month? 17th day. So notice how exact God is being. Second month, 17th day, waters begin. Seventh month, 17th day, waters are gone. How many days between them, according to the Bible? 150 days, right? So how many months is from second to seventh? 5 months. So then how many days in a month? 30 days, right? So 5 months of 30 days is 150 days. And there are only 12 months in the Bible. You can show that through numerous scriptures. All right, so that's why a biblical year has only 360 days and not 365. All right, every month is exactly 30. It's not, you know, 30, then 31, then 28, sometimes 29, then 30. It doesn't do it like that. It's exact. 30, 30, 30, 30. Perfect circle. 360. Starts here. Goes around, starts again. 360 degrees. Perfection. Are you with me? Okay. So according to Genesis 7 and 8, it did something very interesting for us. 150 days is how many months? 5 months. Now remember Revelation chapter 9. How long was Islam released upon the earth? 5 months. So that 5 months represents 150 days, right? 150 days, 5 months. Are we all together? Okay. So, here we have 5 months equals 150 days. Now, when we talk about 5 months or 150 days, in the Bible, we know a day represents a year. You know, Ezekiel 4, 6 and Numbers 14, 34 and other like scriptures. All right, so one day represents a year. So therefore, how many days, or 150 days represents 150 years. All right, so we're going to put years. Now, you can't see the charts behind me, but I'll just write it up here. When Islam was released upon the earth, they were under different rulers. It started with the Prophet Muhammad. And although he had people that were willing to die and fight for him, Islam was not really organized until a man by the name of Othman came along. Now, when Othman took over, you know, from Muhammad, then Abu Bakr, and then, you know, other rulers, but Othman, when he took over, he organized Islam. And this is when they really began their military exploits. And it wasn't until July, I'm going to write it here, it wasn't until July 1299, July 27, 1299, this is when Othman first makes war on the Roman armies, all right, and he enters into the area known as Nicomedia, and this is, begins the Battle of Nicomedia, July 27, 1299, okay? So when the Bible is talking about they were given time to hurt men for 5 months, it begins here, July 27, 1299, all right? So we're in Bible study together, right? Add with me, do some math now. Add 150 years to 1299. What do we get? 1449, brother, quick on math, right? All right, so 150 years. Now remember, God is exact. And I really want you to notice something about this. Revelation chapter 9, you've probably seen many different time prophecies in the Bible, right? You've seen many different time prophecies in Scripture, and I'm going to give you time to give me all the time prophecies in just a moment, because it's going to help us in our study. But there's something about the prophecies of time relating to Islam that God needs you to be exact, even to the day. Okay? So I want you to notice what God does. He gives you the 150 days or years that begin July 27, 1299, and bring us to July 27, 1449. Okay, so this 150 years is up July 27, 1449. You with me so far? Well, I know we're a little bit out of the ordinary this morning, but that's okay. So July 27, 1299, 150 years, brings us to July 27, 1449. 5 months is now completed. And they were only given power to hurt men. Is there a difference between hurting and killing? Yes. So for 150 years, you read back in Revelation chapter 9. You read back verses, 1 through 13. And you'll see very clear they're only given power to hurt for 150 years. But when that time period is up, notice the difference now. Go back there to Revelation 9. Go back to Revelation chapter 9. Revelation chapter 9. Let's look at verse 13 again. Revelation chapter 9. We're looking at verse 13. Let me know that you're there by an amen. The Bible says, "And the sixth angel sounded, and I heard a voice from the four horns of the golden altar, which is before God, say to the sixth angel, which had the trumpet, loose the four angels which are bound in the great river Euphrates." So these angels were bound, right? Or they were restrained. There was a time period where they were only given power to hurt. Now look at what happens in verse 15. "And the four angels were loosed, which were prepared for an hour, a day, a month, and a year, for to what? Slay the third part of men." So for 150 days or years, they're given power to hurt. Now their chains are loosed, and they're given power to do what? To slay or to kill. And how long are they given to kill? An hour. All right, so I'm going to write down 1 hour, 1 day, 1 month, and 1 year. All right, so let's do this. Let's find out what this represents. A day represents a what in Bible prophecy? A year. All right, how many days in a prophetic year? Or excuse me, 1 day, 1 year. We'll just do it this way. 1 day, 1 year. All right, so this is 1 year. So 1 day represents 1 year, yes or no, prophetically. I know some of you might not be able to see. This might be in the way. I'm sorry. 1 month, how many days in a month? 30. So this 1 month represents 30 days or 30 years. And then 1 year, how many days in a year? 360. All right, so this is 360 days or years. All right, so if we were to add that together, 360 plus 30 plus 1, what is that? You were quicker on that 150-year one, right? So 360 plus 30 is what? 390 plus 1, 391. All right, so 391 years is represented here. But now we have to figure the hour. The hour is a little different, right? 1 hour, if you were to do my most hated thing in math, and all my children know, fractions. Right, I hate fractions. But if you were to break up a day into a fraction, if you were to break it up in fractions, how many hours in a day? 24. So what would 1 hour be in a fraction? 1/24, right? So 1/24 of a day. Right? That's an hour. But the year is how many days? Because a day represents a year. 360. So what is 1/24 of 360? 15. All right. So this is 15 literal days now. We've done we've taken it from the prophetic understanding now to literal. Okay. So 1 day equals 1 year. 1 month, 30 years, 1 year, 360, 1 hour is 1/24th of a day, 1/24th of a year, right, is 15. So this is 15 days. So 391 years and 15 days. How many have ever seen God become so exact when it comes to a time prophecy? Usually you read about 2,300 days, 1,260 days, right? But now he's saying 391 years and 15 days. Now, all we have to do is add it to where this one ended. The first time prophecy for Islam began July 27, 1299 with the Battle of Nicomedia. They were given 5 months, which is 150 days. Brings you to July 27, 1449. Now their next time prophecy starts. And now they're loosed to slay men for 391 years and 15 days. So now, let's do some more math. Last bit of math. Add 391 to 1449. Huh? My sister said 1840. Okay? So 1840, and that's correct. Now we have to add 15 days to July 27. And you come to August 11. It's a terrible G. August 11, 1840, okay? So when you come to August 11, 1840, this is where Revelation 10 begins. Revelation 10 says, and I saw another mighty angel come down from heaven, right? So when you come to the end of the time prophecy of 391 years and 15 days, the rest of Revelation chapter 9 is just describing that 391 year period, okay? When you come to the end, August 11, 1840, the mighty angel comes down. This is the beginning now of Revelation chapter 10. So I'm going to write this on our board here. 1840, this is August 11. August 11, 1840. Then we've already seen in Revelation chapter 10 the disappointment, the first disappointment, the spring of 1844, and the second disappointment, the autumn of 1844, where time is no longer. All right, so for our study now, no more time prophecy. You might be happy to know that, right? No more math now. All right, time is no longer. So we're done with this now. All right, so August 11, 1840, spring of 1844, autumn of 1844. We're just doing basic waymarks now. Basic waymarks. Now I'm going to erase this so I can have a little bit of room. All right? So what brings the angel down? What brings the angel down? It's a question. What brings the angel down? That was the question we asked in Revelation 10:1. Mighty angel comes down. What brings him down? Huh? The four sultans were loosed for how long? I've erased the cheat sheet now, right? Well, the 150 years was the first time prophecy, right? They're given power to hurt. Now they're given power to slay for an hour, a day, a month, and a year. 391 years, 15 days. We can't forget the 15 days. You see, without that time prophecy, let me just say this. This is why God is so exact. He's more exact with that time prophecy than he was with the 2300 days. You see, without that time prophecy, there would be no Seventh-day Adventism. Without that time prophecy, you and I would not be here. The Bible would still be sealed up. That particular time prophecy is what unseals, really, the understanding of Scripture for us. And what I mean by that is this. And I have a statement in there that we'll read in just a little while. But August 11, 1840 was a wonderful fulfillment of Bible prophecy. You ever heard of a man by the name of Josiah Litch? All right, Josiah Litch, you know, a month before this whole transaction took place, August 11, 1840, he puts into print and he predicts, based upon Miller's rules, based upon the rules the Millerites were using to understand that Christ was going to come in 1844, the spring of 1844, and then the autumn of 1844, based on those rules, he was able to say that the power of Islam that had been attacking the world for first 150 years and then 391 years and 15 days was going to come to its end August 1840. Now, you're talking about a power that for nearly, almost 450 years was doing its work on the earth, and no one can deal with them. And all of a sudden, some little man says, hey, they're going to come to their end August of 1840. Now, what do you think the world would do? Well, these people are crazy, right? But then 10 days before the event, he says, and this was August 1st, right? He says, you know what? Not just in the month of August, but I've correctly, predicted based on Bible prophecy, it will be August 11th, 1840, this will happen. And of course, 10 days before the event, the people are like, these guys are crazy. But guess what happened? August 11, 1840, the event exactly fulfilled the prediction. And an impetus comes into the Advent movement because, wait a minute, here are these people that are using the Bible to interpret itself. And they're able to predict world events before they happen based on Bible prophecy. Could it be that when they say the world is coming to its end in 1844, they're correct? And so where it was only like 50 or 40 people that were at the meetings, now it went to overflowing where there was standing room only. And they had to turn people away because there was no more room in the meeting halls. Or this is the power that comes into the Advent movement without the understanding of time prophecy. And the verification of time prophecy, the Bible still would have been a sealed book. So October 22, 1844, that's the pillar and foundation of the Advent movement. But August 11, 1844 is the key that unlocks Scripture. Without it, you and I would have no reason to be here. All right? So let's get into a few other things quickly here. On your paper there, you should have on page 2. Page 2, I want to read a statement. For the sake of time, we'll forego looking at a lot of the scriptures to prove this here. I'll give you one or two. But I just want to read quickly on page 2. At the beginning of page 2, you see 7 BC 971. You see that there? Okay, now this is in reference to Revelation chapter 10. Yes, ma'am. I just told you that there was a disappointment. I haven't given you the reason. We're going to get into that. We're going to get into that, all right? So everything I say, I promise, I'll give you reason for it, okay? So autumn of 1844, second disappointment. Spring of 1844, first disappointment. August 11, 1840, mighty angel comes down, all right? Now this mighty angel in Revelation 10, who is this mighty angel? This is the question that after asking myself the question, what brings the angel down, I ask questions like, well, who is this? If the angel represents things, right? You know, the angel in Revelation chapter 9, that star represented Muhammad. The four angels bound in the great river Euphrates represented the four principal sultans. So who is this angel in Revelation chapter 10? It's Jesus, all right? Look at the statement here. It says, the mighty angel who instructed John was no less a personage, or it was no less the person than Jesus Christ, setting his right foot upon the sea and his left foot upon dry land, shows the part that he is acting in the closing scenes of the great controversy with Satan. This position denotes his supreme power and authority over the whole earth. All right, now let me just show you how you can show this. I'll give you a few texts. In the book of Revelation chapter 10, it gives you some descriptions of this mighty angel. It says that he was clothed with a what? Revelation 10, verse 1. This mighty angel comes down from heaven. He's clothed with a cloud. He has a rainbow upon his head. His face was, as it were, the sun, and his feet as what? Pillars of fire. All right, now what you do is this. I'm going to give you something to study on your own. Who is clothed in the Bible with a cloud? Take your concordance, look up cloud or clouds, and you'll find text that talks about who's clothed with a cloud. And I'll already tell you, it's God. He's the one that is hidden and clothed with clouds. All right, the Bible said, what was upon his head? A rainbow was upon his head. Let me give you a verse. It's a very beautiful verse. You know the text. You know the text. Go with me to Genesis chapter 9. First time in the Bible you read about a rainbow. All right, Genesis chapter 9. Notice what your Bible says. Genesis chapter 9. I want you to go with me to verse 11. Genesis 9, verse 11. All right, the flood is over. God is giving his promise to his people. What was the promise? That there would never be a flood again on the earth. All right, the rainbow, right? But I want you to notice the language of this verse, often overlooked. Notice what it says, Revelation 9, verse 11. And I will establish my covenant with you, neither shall all flesh be cut off any more by the waters of a flood, neither shall there any more be a flood to destroy the earth. And God said, this is the token of the covenant which I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for perpetual generations. I do set what? My bow in the cloud, and it shall be for a token of a covenant between me and the earth. It doesn't say I will set the bow. He says, I will set what? My bow. And the reason for that is this. God has always been the one surrounded by a rainbow. You can actually see this in Ezekiel chapter 1. In Ezekiel chapter 1, where Ezekiel sees the Lord sitting upon the throne, the Bible describes his loins, from his loins upward, you know, there's fire. From his loins downward, there's fire, right? But it describes the glory of the Lord as the glory of the bow that is in the clouds after the day of rain. So that glory that is surrounding God is the color of a rainbow. So I want you to think of this now. You'll have a deeper appreciation of the rainbow. When you see the rainbow in the clouds now, friends, I want you to remember this. It's not just a natural phenomena that God puts in the cloud, because it would have been there from the beginning. If it's just a prism and bending of light, it would have always been there. But after the flood, God put his bow in the cloud. Every time you see that, that is the glory of God in the sky. That's what that is. It's the glory of the Lord in the sky. So God is the one that's hid by the cloud. God is the one that's surrounded by a rainbow. Look at Revelation chapter 1. Look at Revelation chapter 1. It said this angel's face was as it were the sun, and his feet as pillars of fire. Look at Revelation chapter 1. Revelation. Go with me to the first chapter. Revelation chapter 1. And let's start together in verse 12. Revelation chapter 1, we'll start in verse 12. The Bible says, and I turned to see the voice that spake with me. And being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. And in the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto who? The Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, girt about the paps with a golden girdle. Who's the Son of Man? Christ. It says, the head, his head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes as a flame of fire, and his feet like unto fine brass, as if they had been what? Burned in a furnace, and his voice as the voice of many waters. And he had in his right hand seven stars. Out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance, what is someone's countenance? Their face. His countenance was as the sun shineth in his strength. So who's the one whose face is like the sun? That's Christ. His feet here are burnt, or the color of brass, burned in a furnace. So when it describes his feet as, you know, pillars of fire, you know, I think it's very interesting. Let me just throw this on you as well. Every time I see the rainbow now, I look at it and I was like, man, you know, that's actually God's glory that's in the cloud. And it just makes me awe even more. But then I think about, you remember when the children of Israel were brought out of Egypt? What followed them by day and by night? The pillar of cloud by day, right? And who's the one clothed with a cloud? That's God, right? Christ specifically. And by night, it's pillars of fire. Now, I find this very interesting. Do you remember Paul in 1 Corinthians? We read this last week in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. And he talks about how, you know, that history was, you know, an ensample upon us, upon whom the ends of the world are come. It describes how all of our fathers were baptized unto Moses in the sea and in the cloud. And it says that, you know, they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. All right, well, that rock that followed them, you look in the Old Testament, we know it wasn't like a stone following them. It was a symbol of Jesus, right? But he symbolized himself as cloud and fire. Now, in the Bible, which is very powerful thing if you think about it, in the daytime, you know, he manifested himself as a pillar of cloud to keep them from the heat of the day, right? But in Scripture, the Bible shows that he's the one that's clothed with clouds. A panoply of clouds covers him. So the rock that was following them, or in reality, that the language of the Hebrew means, or the Greek rather, means the rock that they followed. All right, so they were following the pillar of cloud, which was Christ. So that pillar of cloud was not just a cloud standing straight. It was Christ walking before them, covered by the cloud. Are you with me? But at night, it was a pillar of what? And they were walking behind this pillar of fire, right? Well, the Bible shows those were his legs, his feet. So as he's walking, they're walking behind this pillar of fire. In the daytime, they're walking behind the pillar of cloud. It's Christ. It's God. So friends, these were not just phenomena of a cloud straight up or a fire straight up. This was actually God himself moving before his people. All right? It's a beautiful thing when you think about it. So when you come to Revelation 10, and the Bible says this mighty angel comes down and it describes the angel. Who is this angel? It's Christ. He's clothed with a cloud, a rainbow is upon his head, his face is as the sun, his feet as pillars of fire. All right, so you can just think about it. That's a powerful thing. You know, it kind of makes me get a little goosebumps, you know, want to be around that, right? And one day we're going to be able to see him face to face. This is powerful stuff. But the Bible says that this angel that comes down is Christ. He comes down August 11, 1840. What brought him down was the fulfillment of the time prophecy of the 391 years and 15 days that was given to Islam. It was fulfilled August 11, 1840. So mighty angel comes down, he descends, and this empowers the Advent movement. Okay? It empowered the movement. Now, some other questions I ask myself. If the mighty angel is now coming down from heaven, you know, he's descending from heaven. That means that before his descent, where was he? He was in heaven, right? And what do angels do? What do angels do? If they're in heaven, you know, they're going back and forth, but you would see this angel flying in heaven, right? But then August 11, 1840 brings the angel down. So before coming down, he's flying in heaven, okay? All right, so I want you to keep this in your mind. We know this angel represents Christ. Why is Christ called a mighty angel? Why is he described as a mighty angel? You see, before this, in chapter 5, he was described as the lamb that had been slain. Chapter 6, he's the lamb slain. You know, before this, you know, he's the Son of Man. He's all these different terms. He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah. We know all of this is Jesus. Why now is he being described as a mighty angel? Why not just say that, you know, the Son of Man came down? Or this, you know, the Lion of the tribe of Judah? Or, you know, the lamb that had been slain. Why is he described as a mighty angel? So that's another question that you ask yourself. You have an answer, maybe. Don't be afraid. Why would he be called the mighty angel? Why do you think? All right, it's showing the exalted character of the work. He's empowering the Advent movement. I agree with that 100%. But let's look at some things, right? I think you have this on your paper. I know you have this on your paper. I asked the questions all in bold there on page 2. Why is Christ described as a mighty angel? You see that there? You have it on your paper? Okay. Why is Christ described as a mighty angel? So then it says the mighty angel, and it gives you four points. We all there together? All right, we've read Revelation 10 already. We've already read Revelation 10. It says the mighty angel proclaims a special message. Doesn't he come down and with a loud voice give a message, right? So he's proclaiming a special message. He utters his proclamation with a loud voice. He refers to the great creator as the maker of heaven and earth, the sea, and the things that are therein. And number four, he proclaims time, that there shall be time no longer, which points to what? The judgment. We know autumn of 1844 brings us to the investigative judgment, right? October 22, 1844, Christ goes from the holy to the most holy place. So that's the judgment. So notice this. I don't want you to miss it. Here's this mighty angel. Where is he? Before coming down, where is he? He's in heaven. So here you have this mighty angel. He's flying in the midst of heaven. He's giving a message with a loud voice. Where does this message go to? Where does the message go to? To the earth, but where on the earth? You see him standing upon the sea and upon the dry land. What does water represent in the Bible? Peoples, nations, multitudes, tongues. So dry land being the exact opposite of that, if water represents multitude, what does dry land represent? Sparsely populated, right? Now we know from our study of prophecy that all the kingdoms of Bible prophecy come out of the sea, except for one. One nation comes out of the earth. And who is the nation that comes out of the earth? The United States of America, the New World, right? So the waters represent the old world. The earth represents the new world. So here's this angel flying in the midst of heaven. He's giving a message with a loud voice. This message goes to what? The whole world, right? We could even say to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. How does he give the message? Loud voice. All right, what does he say? He makes reference to the creator of heaven, earth, sea, right? And he says, time is no longer, which brings you to the judgment. What angel does this sound like? An angel that flies in the midst of heaven. He gives a special message with a loud voice. He goes to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. He makes reference to the creator. And he ends the message by saying that time is no longer, or the hour of his judgment is come. What angel is this? Come on, we say it every Sabbath. First angel's message. Go with me to Revelation 14. Revelation 14. There's a reason, friends, why Christ is described as a mighty angel. And when we're studying our Bibles, and I remember, you know, it wasn't too long ago, in December, we had our winter week of prayer. And all of us, myself included, you know, said we were going to study our Bibles more. Well, friends, when we study our Bibles, and I haven't forgot about the classes, right? We're going to learn how to study Scripture. All right, but I'm giving you tips and technique now. Always ask questions. You know, I was reading a story with our daughters. Every Sabbath, the opening of Sabbath, we have a story that we're going through. We're going through a book. Do you remember what the title of it is? Into the Blizzard, the story of Jack Zachary, the heretic of the North, right? All right, it's a true story about a young man who converts from, you know, Catholicism to Adventism, and he becomes a great Bible worker for the Lord. And it's all his true story. It's a wonderful, wonderful story. But one of the things about this young boy is he was very inquisitive. He asked so many different questions, and it would get on the parents and adults' nerves, because he would, why is this? The parents would answer, and they would say, okay, well, if that is that, then why is that? And if this is this, then why is this? And you know how children get, right? And sometimes his parents were like, look, just because I said so. But that's not how we should be. That inquisitive nature, as parents, we can stifle that in our children. And when it comes to the time of them getting older and they begin to study their Bible, they won't ask those questions anymore. And when they don't ask those questions anymore, they never get anything out of the study of the Bible. That inquisitive nature, God has placed that in us naturally, so that when we're reading something or when we're studying something or when the minister says something, the child of God says, but why is that? And if that is that, then what is this? All right, these things we must do. Ask questions. Very important to ask questions. All right, so Revelation 14, look at verse 6. Revelation 14, verse 6. The Bible says, and I saw another angel fly where? In the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth and to every nation, kindred, and tongue, and people. Is he giving a special message? Yes, he is. How does he give it? Verse 7. Saying with a loud voice, fear God, give glory to him. Why? For the hour of his judgment has come, and worship him that made heaven and earth, the sea and the fountains of waters. Same description as the mighty angel of Revelation 10. So, what Christ is doing here, he's identifying himself with the message of the first angel. And if you have a first, that's followed by the second, then followed by the third, right? Christ is identifying himself with the messages of the first, second, and third angel, but specifically the first here. And there's a reason for it. Before he comes down, he was first flying in heaven. Okay? So now we have to ask ourselves the question. We identified historically when he came down. We're identifying when the first disappointment is. We're identifying when the second disappointment is. So now what we want to identify quickly is, when was he flying in heaven? Not when he came down, but when was he flying in heaven with a message to give to all the earth? All right, so notice this. You have in your paper there, Great Controversy. Great Controversy 355. Great Controversy 355. We're still on page 2. Great Controversy 355. And I have no special burden to rush through this. So I'm just taking my time. Is that okay? All right. So Great Controversy 355, paragraph 1. Great Controversy 355, paragraph 1. Are we all there on your paper? All right. When was Christ flying in heaven? In other words, when does the first angel's message enter history? We know when it comes down and empowers, but when does it enter history? That's another way you can ask yourself the question. So Great Controversy 355 to 356. Great religious, it should say, a great religious awakening under the proclamation of Christ's soon coming is foretold in the prophecy of what? The first angel's message of Revelation 14. An angel is seen flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. With a loud voice he proclaims the message, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment has come. Worship him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of waters. The fact that an angel is said to be the herald of this warning is significant. By the purity, the glory, and the power of the heavenly messenger, divine wisdom has been pleased to represent the exalted character of the work to be accomplished by the message and the power and the glory that were to attend it. And the angel's flight in the midst of heaven and the loud voice with which the warning is uttered is and its proclamation unto all that dwell on the earth, to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people, give evidence of the rapidity and the worldwide extent of the movement. The message itself sheds light as to the one time when this movement is to take place. So she's talking about the first angel, Revelation 14. And she says the message itself gives you the time when this is to take place. It is declared to be a part of the everlasting gospel, and it announces the opening of the judgment. The message of salvation has been preached in all ages, but this message is a part of the gospel which could be proclaimed only in the last days, for only then would it be true that the hour of the judgment had come. The prophecies present a succession of events leading down to the opening of the judgment. This is especially true of the book of Daniel. But that part of his prophecy which related to the last days, Daniel was bidden to close up and seal to the time of the end. Not until we reach this time could a message concerning the judgment be proclaimed based on the fulfillment of these prophecies. But at the time of the end, says the prophet, many shall run to and fro and knowledge shall be increased. The apostle Paul warned the church not to look for the coming of Christ in his day. That day shall not come, he said, except there come a falling away first and the man of sin be revealed. Not until after the great apostasy and the long period of the reign of the man of sin can we look for the advent of our Lord. The man of sin, which is also styled the mystery of iniquity, the son of perdition, and that wicked represents the papacy, which as foretold in prophecy was to maintain its supremacy for how long? 1260 years. This period ended when? 1798. The coming of Christ could not take place before that time. Paul covers with his caution the whole of the Christian dispensation down to the year 1798. It is this side of that time that the message of Christ's second coming is to be proclaimed. No such message has ever been given in past ages. Paul, as we have seen, did not preach it. He pointed his brethren into the far distant future for the coming of the Lord. The reformers did not proclaim it. Martin Luther placed the judgment about 300 years after the future of his day. Now let's pause on that. Isn't that interesting? Martin Luther put the judgment how many years? 300 years. Now Martin Luther, during the time of the 1500s, 1517 is this, you know, this great reformation. So that puts the coming of the judgment into when? The 1800s. Was he right? Yes, he was. Notice this though. But since what year? 1798, the book of Daniel has been unsealed, knowledge of the prophecies has increased, and many have proclaimed the solid message of the judgment near. And so the message itself of the coming judgment can only be given after the year what? 1798. So this is when the angel enters history. Okay? So 1798. Now, I'm going to bring this to a close in just a moment, and we'll pick up here next week. But what Revelation 10 is, and let's review, because we've said a lot, but we've actually only dealt with a portion of things. Okay? We've just said a lot about that portion. Revelation 10 is the history and the experience of the Advent movement. Yes or no? Yes. The history and experience of the Advent movement is repeated. Yes or no? It is repeated to the very letter. Yes or no? Yes. Now, it's very important that I identify this, okay? This is the history that the Bible and Spirit of Prophecy identify as repeating to the very letter. This history. And the reason why I say that is because many people like to take any history and they pick and choose in history and they say, well, this is repeating and this is Listen, what repeats is what inspiration identifies as repeating. It's the history of the Millerite movement from 1798 to the autumn of 1844. That is Matthew 25. That's the parable of the 10 virgins. Okay? There are statements that we'll read next week. But when it comes to Matthew 25, remember they're going forth to meet the bridegroom. Remember the message that the bridegroom was coming? That message was the first angel. And they understood that. They believed that the message of the bridegroom's coming was the first angel's message. Okay? They also believed that there came a point in time where there was a tarrying time and a disappointment and delay. Or they identified that in the parable. They identified that there was a midnight cry, behold the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him. They identified all these different things as part of the parable. All right, that's Matthew 25. But this history is not just Matthew 25, it's also Revelation 14, 6 through 12. When you say your affirmation of faith every Sabbath, it's not just giving principles of a message, you're actually repeating the movements of history. And the reason why I'm touching it from this angle is because most of us don't think of that when we say this. And if we downgrade the three angels' messages to, you know, I mean, let's be honest, and I've said this before, when you're going through the affirmation of faith and you're reading things about, you know, the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever, and you're reading all these different things, it's kind of like, can we give another affirmation? You know, why not just, you know, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son? You know, why not, you know, Daniel 8:14, you know, unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. Why can't we use that one? Why do we go through the three angels? Well, friends, it's not just because the name of our church is Three Angels Fellowship. All right, that might be part of it. But this is identifying, friends, for us, not only our work, it's identifying our message and our history. And we must understand it. When we downgrade it, you're downgrading sacred history that the Bible, through painstaking effort, has placed in sacred pages for the people of God to study. All right, this is the game plan, friends. When we understand what's taking place here, you're going to understand your day. Very important. And it's the devil that would want this to be sealed up to us. And it's very, very important that we understand these things. So Revelation 10 is the events and the experience of the Advent movement. Revelation 10 takes you from 1798 to the autumn of 1844. The angel's flying in heaven, 1798, he enters history. What angel enters history, 1798? What angel? Out of the first, second, or third? First, okay? So I'm going to put 1 a.m. here. That's not 1 a.m. like 1 in the morning. First angel's message, okay? All right, so this is the first angel's message entering history. This is the first angel's message being empowered when the angel comes down. You with me? All right. So we're going to pause there. I won't get into the second and the third, so on and so forth. I just want to kind of review some things. So the first angel comes down, is in history, 1798. He's flying in heaven. August 11, 1840, he comes down to the earth. Then there's the spring, which is the first disappointment of 1844, and the second disappointment of the autumn of 1844. This is the broad history, broad strokes. We're doing broad strokes now. No detail yet. We'll do detail as we move along. But this is the time frame of Matthew 25's parable of the 10 virgins. This is the time frame of Revelation 14, 6 through 12. This is the time frame also then of Revelation 18. Because Revelation 18, as we will see, is the repeat of the first, second, and third angels' messages. And we'll see this as we study. But again, let me just close with a Bible text. I'll do it that way. Go with me to the book of Ecclesiastes. Let's close with a text. Close with some Bible. I think it's appropriate. Ecclesiastes chapter 3. Ecclesiastes chapter 3. And when you get to chapter 3, give me an amen. Ecclesiastes 3. Again, like I'm saying, I have no great burden to rush through this. I'm going to take my time. So therefore, I want you to make sure you bring those papers back with you next Sabbath. All right, we're going to continue with that handout. We don't want to waste paper, right? We don't want to waste the church ink. So don't come back, you know, next Sabbath saying, oh, I forgot mine, or I threw it away, or so on and so forth. Otherwise, you'll just have to get with somebody that has one. I'm not going to print out another one for you. All right, can we do that? Put it in your Bible. Bring it next Sabbath. We'll have some extra for those who are not here. But for you who are here, write your name on it. Bring it back. All right, we're going to continue to go through this. Next week, we're going to identify the second angel's message, the third angel's message. And then we're going to identify Revelation 10's seven thunders. Okay, we're going to do this together next week. Okay, so we're going to continue to look through these things, identifying the history and the experience of the first, second, and third angel. But we're in Ecclesiastes 3 and verse 15. Why is it important for us to go through our history? Look at verse 15 with me. When you're there, give me an amen. The Bible says, that which hath been is what? Is now. And that which is to be hath what? Already been. And here's the point. And God what? Requireth that which is past. Friends, God requires the past. He requires that you know the past. You know, we say this all the time. We have nothing to fear for the future except as we forget what? How God has led us and his teachings in our past history. God requires the past. He requires that we know the past. He requires that we study the past. And he's put these things in the Bible. And it's my burden to not only show you how to find these things in Scripture, in the spirit of prophecy, it's my burden to also help you know them, whether you're young or old, but also to be able to understand how to study the Bible so that you can see these things on your own. All right? And I'll tell you now, there's a statement that we will read. I believe it's in the notes that I've given you now. If not, it'll be in upcoming notes that I'll hand you. We're told very clear the understanding of the first, second, and third angel, where it's located in history. Understanding this will keep us from the many delusive snares of Satan. Now, when I read something like that in the spirit of prophecy, and she says the understanding of the location of these messages, where they are in history, will keep me from the delusions and snares of Satan, that shows me that it's important. And there is a special temptation, friends, that God is bringing within the Advent movement, there's a special temptation that the God of this world is bringing into the Advent movement right now. And that is the rearranging and the mislocation of these messages. And it sounds good, it even looks good when it's being taught, but if we don't understand where they're located, and we read a statement last week that no man has the authority to move a peg or a pin of these messages. If we start rearranging things, then it's going to lead God's people astray. And I mentioned this last week, and I'll mention it now. I believe I mentioned it last week. Maybe it was in Jamaica when I said this. But if I'm on a trip, if I'm going from point A to point B, I don't have a GPS, or let's say I do have a GPS. I use my smartphone. I'm using Google Maps. And Google is telling me, you know, it's 1, 2, 3, right? But Google is telling me that, you know, this one is here and this one is there and switching me all up. Am I going to get to my destination? You ever had an experience where your GPS takes you just to Timbuktu and you wonder why it took you there? You were following the waymarks, but they were rearranged. Friends, if we're on our upward journey to glory and there are marks along the way that inspiration has said we must identify so that we don't get caught up in the delusive snares of the devil, if I've rearranged them and moved them out of their place, am I going to make it to my destination? Not at all. And so, friends, it's very important that you and I study our Bibles and learn these things as we're going through our sixth pillar of our faith, the three angels' messages, looking not just at the message themselves, but at the history that the message represents. We'll look at the message itself in the upcoming days. So with that being said, let's just close our eyes for a word of prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord, for the time we can study together. Ask you in Jesus' name to be with us as we take this chunk by chunk, piece by piece. We ask, Lord, that you would give us studious minds. May we have on our thinking caps. May we be able to recall these things. We claim your promise of John 14:26, that you will bring back to our remembrance whatsoever you have told us. And so, Father, as we are learning these things, bring it back to our remembrance. Help us to quiz ourselves. Help us to take good notes and to go back over them so that we may be able to locate these messages so that we will not be taken off guard and be fallen into the snares of the devil. Thank you, Lord, for your wonderful kindness in putting these things in Scripture. Thank you for the great goodness and blessing of the Spirit of prophecy. And I pray, Lord God, that we would study our Bibles in 2016 like never before, because our salvation depends on it, is our prayer in Jesus' name.